So, my name is Ludovic Gilet. I'm working in Ebersol Lab, and I'm going to introduce you today about the automatic pig picking for peptide-centric chromatogram analysis. So, you will see in the workflow where it sits between pretty much at the end of your workflow after the development of SRM assays, data acquisition on the triple quad instruments. Skyline helps you basically to visualize your chromatograms and to see what's your chromatographic trace and signals that you have acquired on your instrument. And we are sitting now at the peptide identifications, just before the validation for quantifications. And you have done this a little bit this afternoon, just before, I guess. So you have checked how your data looks like, what's the peak looks like, and how you can trust on a peptide identification. So I'm going to expand on what you have done this afternoon in order to see how actually we do that now in an automatic fashion, just to be unbiased and completely get also a false discovery rate estimation, etc., on this type of data set. So the reason why you want to do this automatically is you've seen this afternoon visually assessing the quality of a peak for a peptide identification can be very objective, highly subjective, sorry. So some people will trust this is a peak, some people know I don't trust it, it's not exactly co-eluting, etc. So you have to have really an objective manner how to assess the identification of your peptides. And then the question is also about the scale. So if you're checking now for a few peptides in few samples, it's still okay. But now when you rescale up your SRM measurements, let's say hundreds of patient samples for a cohort, or if you speak about DIA types of analysis, you're speaking about tens of thousands of peptides in a single file, this is going to be very difficult to do this visually. So we have implemented different ways how to automatize the peak detection. We need to report an objective quality scoring for the peaks, and we need actually to estimate the false discovery rate of your peak detection for the peptide identification. And this is what we call the peak scoring and false discovery rate assessment. So this is the type of data you have seen just before, I guess, with your SRM tutorial this afternoon. Looks pretty nice, simple peak in a pretty flat chromatograms. There's hardly anything to say about it. Nice coelution of the peak trace, pretty happy. But only sometimes your data looks like this. So I'm going to show you a few cases where it gets actually a little bit more tricky. So here, okay, it's not scheduled, it's still the full chromatogram, but you will see that already here. And you understand here that you're actually only measuring five transitions. And as you can believe here, those are just the interference that you have from the, even though the Q1, Q3 acquisition in SRM gives you everybody what says like a very specific assays, you can see actually the specificity in a full lyset is not that specific. So all these peaks is basically interference, is only one of them is correct. And the question is, how do you get the correct peak now from this? So you have seen this afternoon maybe already that an additional information to get the peak is, so here, for example, you see actually these two high impedance peaks here. They have actually both of them very nice peak shapes. It's quite hard to tell them apart from each other which one would be correct. So an external information that you have very often when you generate your assays, you have to remember it's a spectral library, okay? So the question is, how close is, if this is a good spectra? Is, for example, here you see the Y9 transition is actually, the Y9 fragment is the highest one. So you can see here, this is the Y9, and here the highest one is only the Y6. So this is an indication here that this is the correct peak, for example. And in Skyline, you have to remember, maybe you have seen that this afternoon a little bit, you have a score which is called a dot product, which is basically a vector angle dot product between two different vectors containing these transitions. And as you can see here, this is discriminating between the true peak versus the false peak. So this is the first already additional idea. You have coelution of the trace. You have also the similarity to your assay library picture that you have in your prior knowledge of the peptide. So sometimes it gets really, really more tricky. And as you can see here, sometimes even the dot product itself doesn't tell you very much about it. So you can probably reject the very low dot product. But when you have, like in this case, like three peaks which are about 0.99 dot product, it's getting very hard to tell. Even if you have a known spectra on the background to tell them apart. So this is in the case of a peptide in a light background. So if you're lucky and if you have some reference peptides or heavy labeled, for example, a proteome with SILAC, you can also use, you have to remember, you can also use, in this case was yeast, was the N14, was the light endogenous, and N15 was the reference labeled organism. And then in this case, you can do is a direct comparison of light versus heavy. So in Skyline, you can overlay light and the heavy channels in blue and red. And as you can see, only at one place of the chromatograms here, actually, the two peaks nicely coelute together. And this is a very strong discrimination to identify your peak. So here you can see now, if you zoom there and look in the light and in the heavy, you see that the peak shape is similar. The relative intensity between the heavy and the light also similar. This is what we call the relative dot product, which is also a very important score in Skyline that you will see. And therefore, it's an additional confirmation of your peptide identifications. And sometimes, unfortunately, even if you have light and heavy, sometimes the peptide assay that you're trying to identify is actually absent in both channels. In this case, you can reject the hypothesis of presence of your peptide. But if you want to do that in an automatic fashion, the question is how actually do you assess non-detectability of peptides? So all this is very, very subjective. So you say, my peptide is not here, or do I take maybe this little peak here in the noise? It's very hard. So we have, for this purpose, developed basically a set of scores. So those were originally developed for SRM datasets. And as you will see that we expanded this type of analysis to DIA, targeted a peptide-centric chromatogram approach for peptide identifications. So we already went through this little bit intuitively when I went through these different examples. So we use a different sets of scores in order to assess for the identification of your peptide. So the first sets of scores that we use are the intrinsic scores, which are basically only chromatographic based. So the coelution scores tells you about like how well is my, for example, the retention time of my apex matching between the different channels of my different transitions. The peak shapes tells if you go, or the peak having the same peak widths, do the peak going up at the same time, going down at the same times, or do we have an interference that would cause actually a shift in the peak shape? And usually you have also an intensity score that gives, in general, prevalence for the higher intense peaks, for example, versus the lower intense peaks. So these are intrinsic scores that do not need anything else than just the chromatographic information to identify your peptides. In addition, what we have seen also some extrinsic scores that you come from prior knowledge. So the extrinsic scores that we already discussed about is how well is my relative intensity of my transitions matching my assays from my library. So this is an extrinsic score. You need the library prior knowledge in order to do this match. But once you have this match, you can actually compare how well are my transitions matching to my library assays. Another very important extrinsic score is, for example, how well is my retention time of my peptide matching the one I'm expecting. So you know from prior knowledge that your peptide is expected to elute at 20 minutes, and therefore you can expect that in your sample, the targeted peptide should also show up somewhere around 20 minutes. So RT or IRT, if you use also realignments based on a retention time peptide spiked in for the retention time alignments. And the last set of scores that we also use in the example was the PLEX score. So when you use a heavy labeled reference in order to validate, in addition, the confirmation of the light channel identifications. And here you have the same set of scores that you have. You have the label reference intensity correlation between heavy and light. So here you are now not comparing to the library anymore, you're comparing the heavy and the light relative intensity between each other. Now you're comparing here the coelution, so how well is the apex of the heavy and the light coeluting, and how well are the peak shapes of the chromatographic traces matching between the heavy and the light, okay? So these are basically the basic scores that were implemented in this MProfet paper that was published in 2011, and based on that, they implemented this in an automatic manner to have a set of completely objective scores in order to assess the chromatographic identification of your peptides. But what I want to say is, like, exactly like in Shotgun, if you have, let's say, a sequest X core, it's not sufficient actually to identify for sure the spectra. You need actually an extra information which we come from decoy in order to estimate what's the force discovery rate of my identification. And basically here, the idea is that you want to go beyond just those raw scores, and you need to take into account that the change of such coelution, of such coeluting events, occur by chance. And of course, you can think very easily that if you measure a single peptide in a water background, the chance that interfering transition occur in a water background will be very different than, for example, if you measure it like in a human tryptic digest background. So this type of chance of occurring that six transition by chance will just coelute by chance will be very different depending on your sample complexity. And also very important thing that you will see later is the corrections for multiple testing. Because if you measure one peptide or if you measure 10,000 peptides, you will need also to correct for the force discovery rate in order to correct for the multiple testing hypothesis. So, and for this, of course, we do a very similar type of strategy as we do in Shotgun. We will now compare the scores of the target peptides to score of decoy peptides. And as you will see here, the concept is similar, but the implications are actually very different. So the idea of the decoys in targeted proteomics is that we want to assess, again, as I just said, the quality of the peak scoring and the significance of the identifications. And for this, we need to generate assays of reverse or non-natural sequence that are expected not to exist in your sample background. And it's essentially the same thing as you do a target decoy database searching when you do a shotgun identification, okay? So your decoy must look like targets. So the scoring algorithms, the software that you use for the scoring, must not know if it's scoring a target or a decoy. It should be completely agnostic and just score the change that the peak in this chromatographic window is an identification or not. So in terms of decoys, they mean that they have to have similar Q1 distribution as your targets, they have to have similar Q3 distributions for the fragments, they have to have similar retention time windows. So if all your peptides, you're measuring them between 10 and 20 minutes, don't measure your decoy at 40 to 50 minutes, doesn't make any sense. You want to capture the sample complexity in the same mass and retention time dimension as your targets. You want to use similar number of transitions. If you're measuring 5 transitions for targets, you also want to measure 5 transitions for decoys. And you want also to use a similar type of things like relative fragment intensity, etc. So not bias anything for changing the decoys, that the decoy should really look like targets for the software that's going to score them. And I'm going to show you a lot of these plots in the next couple of slides, so I'm not going to explain you exactly how to get them now, but what I want to say is, for example, this is just to give you a first feeling about how it's going to look like. In principle here, you will have always kind of a red distribution that will show you the distribution of the scores of your decoys, and the gray distribution that show you the distributions of the targets, right? And depending what you're looking in your samples, you will see that your sample is going to look like your decoys or is going to look like real identifications. So for example here, if you extract human samples for human assays, you will see that a certain number of peptides of your histograms is moving away from the decoy distributions. But for example, if you extract, let's say, human samples with E. coli assays, you will expect that none of the E. coli peptides should be present in your human samples, and therefore all the E. coli assays that you're extracting in your human samples will exactly fall on top of your decoys, okay? So this is actually how we can now try to think how we can distinguish targets from decoys, okay? And the only point I want to make is that we generated different way and different strategy how we can generate these decoys the most objectively possible, that they look as close as possible to targets. And as you can see here, we extracted the human samples with reverse, for example, or shuffled decoys. And as you can see here, if you do that, it's basically the same distribution as if you extract for E. coli peptides, okay? So this is just the point I want to make here, is that we actually can generate decoys Exactly, by like we do for shotgun database, by reversing the peptide sequence. So you have the same Q1 mass, you will have a certain distribution of Q3, but that will still represent also natural amino acid, but just in a non-natural sequence event. So in terms of what they mean, the decoys, if you do SRM, the decoys have to be measured. So this is something that is very counterintuitive, because you're going to spend time of your measurements measuring noise. But this is actually very important in order, if you want to do this type of objective, unbiased identification, automatic identification, you need to have in your sample a way to assess the chance that these six transitions, for example, will collude by chance. So this is very important. So in SRM, this is going to cost you time. We can discuss about the time. So in principle, you want to measure as many decoys as targets. But sometimes, if you have enough decoys, we can span them across a different injection, etc. The point is that you need to have enough decoys to have a reasonable way how the decoy distribution should look like. I'm going to discuss this in a few minutes. In DIA, it's very different, because in DIA, you basically are unlimited. You're just extracting your data a posteriori, so you don't care anymore how much decoys you want to extract. You can extract whatever you want anyway. And again, the idea is that you want to have this way to assess the chance that this fragment ion traces collude by chance, and you want to, and you will see that it has very different signification between targeted proteomics and shotgun type of decoys. So how this is done in targeted proteomics, I'm going to go through a very simple example. This is a target peptide. You see the sequence. Here it's a DIA, it doesn't really matter, it could be an SRM. Here you have four transitions. This is the mass of your precursor, the mass of the four different transitions. And when you look at the chromatographic trace, you will see that they coelute. And your software basically gives you a score based on the different mini scores I told you before, coelution of traces, matching to the library, etc. Now from this peptide sequence, what you're going to generate is a reverse peptide sequence. So here in this case, I kept the arginine constant on the C-terminus, but you can also basically shuffle or completely reverse the sequence. You will give you a very similar. The idea is that by reversing the sequence, you keep the same mass of the peptide. So you're measuring exactly in the same Q1 window. But you will see here that the fragments, of course, because the sequence now is reversed, the mass of the different fragments is different. So this sequence of fragments in this order should not exist in nature. It's a peptide that doesn't exist in nature. You're just going to assess the chance that these four transitions elute in your sample matrix at this Q1 mass and at this retention time window. And if you measure that, you will get something like this. You will get interferences, as you know from SRM. And as you will see at some place, maybe sometimes, you will have some things that looks like a peak. Okay? So here you see actually it's 3 out of 4 transitions. It's not so bad, it's clearly not the correct peptide, but your software will try to assess what's the score of my best peak in my window, so this is this score, okay? And then you will do basically a plot of all your different identifications of targets and decoys in a histogram, type of plots like this of scores, and then you will see that the, hopefully the target scores will pile up at a relatively higher scores than the decoy scores that will pile up statistically across normal distributions. And there you will try to see actually what is the distinction between your target scores and your decoy scores, okay? So sometimes this is a good case where you have a good peak for the target and a bad peak for the decoy. This is another example where it's the opposite. You're looking for this target. The target is virtually absent from your data. And here, just by chance, these four transitions get you actually a peak here, and as you can see here, the peak scores higher than the decoy peak scores higher than the target peaks. So in this case here, the decoy here, for example, will score rather on the right hand of your red distribution of the score histograms, and the gray will be basically buried down in the tail of the gray distributions. Okay? And the idea is actually to use now this type of distributions in order to get not only the raw scores of these chromatograms, but also an estimation of the fuzzy score rate of your identification for this specific score in your data set. Okay? So this we do again automatically. So as I said, we can use all these mini scores to do these distributions of targets and decoys. So this is done automatically for the by the software for you. And for each of these mini scores, you can basically the distribution of the gray, which is again the targets, and the black, which is the decoys. Okay? And as you can see here, sometimes the targets, I mean, the idea of this course is that each time the target should look different than the decoys. If the targets look like the same than the decoys in your scores, then it means that it's not a good score. But sometimes, for example, here you see the targets score all very well on coelutions, so they score all at coelution score of 1, and the decoys actually rather span quite a high range of scores for the decoys. But you can see, for example, if you look at the retention time deviation from the expected retention time in the middle of your window, all the delta retention time for your targets would be 0, but your decoy in this case, for example, would span basically the whole window completely randomly, and therefore the distributions of your decoys are basically flat. So we see that the distribution of the targets and decoys, depending on the scores and depending on what the scores assess, looks a little bit different. Sometimes the decoys pile up on one side, sometimes the decoys just flatten out, but the targets always show up a differentiation compared to the decoys, okay? And each of these mini scores is informative, but the most informative way is actually to combine them all in the best manner possible, which we call the, in this case, they use linear discriminant analysis, LDA approach, in order to mix them together. Because as you see, some scores are more powerful than some others. So for example, here, that was the, again, the results of this paper. For example, the three most powerful scores, as you can see here, well, this is the multiplex score, but you see, for example, here, the best scoring mini score is the reference shape score. So if you remember, this is the correlation between the heavy and the light coelutions. So shape coelutions of the heavy and the light. The second best scoring one is actually the intensity correlation to the external library that you have prior knowledge for. And the third best one is actually the shape score. So how well are my transitions coeluting shape-wise between each other? Okay, so this is just to give you an information that, and of course, depending how well is your library, how good is your library, how good is your retention time estimation, these different scores will have actually more power or less power depending on your library and depending of your assays quality that you're using. So the best way actually to compile these scores is to use a software and to learn this on every data set. So this is what we do now. We have this type of LDA machine learning, and this is basically nothing more sophisticated than a linear discrimination analysis where you see that each, for example, the score one by itself, you would have a very strong here, not a very strong separation between the targets and the decoys. So they would basically, if you compile the two histograms on that axis, you will have basically a very mixture histograms. And if you compare it now to shape 2, which has a little bit more power in discriminations, you will have a little bit of separation, but still a very large region when the scores overlap. And if you take basically a linear now combination of both scores in this axis here, you will see now you basically have a very nice separation. If you project in this axis, you have very nice separation between decoys and targets. So this is for two dimensions. Now here we're speaking about 8 different scores. So you do this in 8 dimensions and you get the best possible combination of the different scores. And this gives you this type of discrimination which basically compiles the best power of every score. Okay? And this is the final type of histogram plots that I showed you at the beginning. Here you have colors also to help you distinguish what's true targets from what's false targets. But as you can see, the idea is still the same. You want your true targets to separate as much as possible from the decoy distributions, okay? And just as a side note, a question that comes sometimes is actually how many transitions shall I measure, or how many transitions shall I use in order to identify my peptides? And this was also, it was presented as a supplementary information in that paper. And as you can see here, they tested the recall of the different transition tests. And as you can see here, the best recall was achieved for label-free with 6 transitions and for label conditions with 4 transitions. So this was actually the take-home message of that paper, was if you want to do SRM or DIA with work, label-free workflow, the highest recall, you should, in principle, use 6 transitions if you're measuring light only. But if you're measuring light plus heavy, you will get the best results with 4 light and 4 heavy. So this might be also depending on your background. This was measured, for example, in a human lysate, but it, depending on your background, maybe you can actually decrease or increase the number of transitions. But this actually gives you a chance to check what is actually your sensitivity and how many transitions you should use for the best possible recovery of your sensitivity. And again, this is something that we commented, Jay commented this morning, sometimes more transitions are not always better, because you have to think that if you pick more and more transitions than 6, then you actually start to decrease your sensitivity, because you're getting more like noisy transitions, and therefore you also get more chances of interference. And if you get more chances of interference in your window, you will also get more chances that a peak, which colludes by chance, happens somewhere else in your chromatograms, okay? So just the last information about the principal difference between targeted and shotgun proteomics in terms of targets and decoys. I'm going to spend again some time on Friday. I give you the wrap-up talk. I'm going to come back to this because this is actually something that we are still discussing a lot in the community. And this is something which is actually very confusing for people not in the field that come, for example, from shotgun, where they have a preconceived idea about what's decoy and what's a target and decoy database in shotgun. And as you will see here, for targeted proteomics, it's actually very different, the context and the meaning that these concepts have. So in shotgun, if you are used to see these are typical MSMS spectra from shotgun. This, you would say, it's a pretty good spectra. This spectra has actually, in principle, a very high chance, if you're looking for the right database, to have the correct peptide sequence annotated on top of that spectra. So this is what we call a good quality spectrum match. So you usually have 90% chance to get to the correct peptide sequence. This type of medium quality spectra, there are some good peaks, but there are many peaks missing in the middle. You have already a partitioning between a chance that it's hitting the correct or the incorrect database. And if you go for a very, very crappy spectra, then by definition of the decoy database, that is basically assessing for the random match of the spectrum matches, you have 50% chance that this is actually matching a target sequence and 50% chance that you're assessing a decoy sequence, right? So this is the concept which is underlying decoy database searching in shotgun. So what you have to think now is that a spectrum points either to a target or a decoy database sequence. And the decoys here in shotgun provides you a readout of the quality of your spectrum, right? And or the chance that you have actually a random match in your decoy database for your against an in silico spectrum. So here what you have is basically the decoy capture the database, the search space complexity. So for example, if you use smaller database, you will also generate a smaller decoy database. If you're searching, for example, with 10 ppm, or if you're searching with 1 Dalton, you will have many more precursors that you get in your target, but also many more precursors that you get in your decoys. So depending on your modification, if you add more modification, you will get more sequence in your target and more sequence in your decoys, right? So the decoys here, they recapture actually your search space complexity. And the number of decoys, it stays constant. It depends on the number of sequence that you have in your database. It depends also on the number of the search parameters that you provide. But whether you search 1 spectra or 1 million spectra, that spectra with that mass will retrieve always the same number of targets and number of decoys, whether it's search alone or within 1 million, okay? So the number of decoys doesn't increase with the number of tests. The number of decoys increase with the number of complexity of your database search space, okay? So this is very different when you speak about targeted proteomics. So I just commented to you that, for example, if you're searching 40,000 targets, I'm speaking now DIA, but if you are very patient, you can do it also with SRM, you can measure then 40,000 targets. Then in principle, in order to measure, assess the exact fold discovery rate of these 40,000 targets, we also need to extract or to measure 40,000 decoys. Okay, and again here, to make things clear, the decoys capture the noise interference level, so the chance that these 6 transitions happen by chance in your background, okay? And here you see that it's, depending of the series of chromatograph trace, you get either a good score or a bad score. And the decoys here, it provides you a readout of the sample noise or the sample background, okay? Or the chance that these colluting fragment ion traces that should not exist for decoys actually collute and gives you a decent score. So this is a chance of something happening in your sample, right? So here you're capturing the sample complexity. The point here is that the number of decoys that you extract increases the number of targets. So this is a very different comment from before. And here it's very important to correct for multiple testing hypotheses. Because then you cannot use, for example, something that you might have used in shotgun. Decoy counting, this is something you must never use in targeted proteomics. Because you will get fooled and then you will underestimate the false discovery rate. Okay? So this is actually now how we go from these histogram plots to false discovery rate estimation. So as I showed you, the first step is basically to plot these target and decoy scores into these histogram plots. And here again, you have in gray the targets. And you see the targets here, there is a little bit of targets that underlie the red decoy distributions. And in red here, you have the decoy score distributions for the decoys, okay? And now what I will do in color here, I will actually try to show you the different subpopulation underneath. So here you see the targets here, as I showed you here, you had some gray here and some gray under the red. And the gray under the red, you can already assess that these are false targets. Because those exactly match the decoy distributions, those are very likely to be actually false positive in your samples. So these are test fragments that you're looking for. They actually look like a random match, statistically speaking, okay? And here you have the green distribution, which are basically the true targets, the peaks that really looks like peaks, and that really do not look like a random chance of something happening, right? And the decoys here, you can see that you have here a total distributions. But you can realize here this total distribution is actually much, much more prominent compared to the distribution of false targets, right? So if you don't correct for multiple testing, and if you do a simple, what we call naive decoy counting, you will start counting from here, like the shotgun, you start counting from the higher score, counting targets, and then at some point here, you get the first decoys in, and when you get at 1% decoy, then you stop counting, and then you say, these are my true positives, and inside I have 1% false targets, okay? But unfortunately here, because you see that your decoys that you're using or actually much overestimation of the population of the false targets, you will actually have a wrong impression about the decoy counting. And therefore, a very important thing to do is actually to scale down. So this is kind of an imagination that you can, a simplistic imagination that you can take. You scale down this orange dotted curve into the red dotted curve. So the red dotted curve is basically the orange distribution, which is scaled down now to the level of the false targets. So we scale down these distributions until you reach the purple false target distributions. And there you can really say, these are actually my false. And therefore, from here on, I can re-estimate the number of true and false targets with a proper FDR estimation. So this is what we actually call the changing from p-value to q-value. And this is actually mathematically done by using the algorithm which was published by Storey and Tipchirani in 2003. And the concept is that if you plot the p-value density histograms of this type of results, so if your data would be only false, this density histogram is basically the plots of the p-values. So the p-values here, for example, they span between 0 and 1. And for example, the good p-values would be between 0 and 0.005, for example, okay? This would be the good p-values. And because it's a density histogram plot, the total area of this plot is always 1, okay? So in this case here, you have a complete random match. So basically, all your target looks like decoy, and basically the p-values are always at the same level. So this is an indication you basically have all assays which are false. And if now you plot something that looks like a true distribution, it will look something like this. And here you see that actually you have the p-values between 0 and 0.05, actually gives you a bar which is much higher than the others. And you see that the p-value then decreases, and at some point it flattens out. And in this density. So now you still have the area is 1. So most of these peak areas, histogram areas that were here before, now they are plotted on top here. And at the point where actually the p-values, the histogram of these p-value plots flattens out, you get basically the estimation of the proportion of the false targets. And if you use now these projections onto your p-value of 0.05, you basically have the exact estimation of the false positive in your p-value of 0.05. So this is how you can mathematically actually transform the p-value to q-values. And here you basically get, if you use, for example, this mProfit, or you will see that it's also now embedded inside Skyline, you get these q-value plots, where you have actually the p-value histogram plots, where you basically see the flattening out of the p-values. And you see the highest peaks here, which is actually your true positive, and you can estimate what's the level of false positive under your first p-value at 0.05. So you get also this type of recall plots and ROC curves in order to give you also an assessment of which level of scores can you use and how, what is the false discovery rate and what is the recall that you get. So in this case here, you identify 80%, for example, at 1% false discovery rate, you identify 80% of your targets, something like this. So this is to walk you again a couple of examples just that you understand these plots and what do they mean. So this was a very synthetic data set that we use, and we extracted them on purpose for true and for false targets. So we know what we extract for. So it's the same case like you have before the human background. You extract them a human background with 200 human peptides, 800 E. coli peptides that you know absolutely that they should not be there in your human background. So these E. coli peptides are false positives. And then you reverse them both, and then you get the decoy distribution, and the decoy, by definition, should also not be there. So you see in this case here, you have this, but the software doesn't know what's the true and what's the false from. Only you know because you told you extracted mixture of human and E. coli peptides. And you can see here, you have these distributions. The false targets here are much higher, and you have some population of true targets. And as you can see here, this is about 20% of your data set, and 80% of your data set is buried underneath. And you can read the same from these plots that I showed you before. You take 1% for discovery rate, and here you see that you recover about 20% of your data set for 1% for discovery rate. And then you increase the number of true targets. So here you extract 50% human, 50% E. coli. You see now the population actually equals each other. You see. And now you extract now 80% human and 20% E. coli. And here you extract 100% human and 0 false. And now here you can see really what the problem is about. So here if you do a naive decoy counting, we'll actually count here, target, target, target. Here I get my first decoys. You say here, only from here on, this is actually only from here I have my true positives. So you will actually here underestimate, you will only report 50% of your targets as being true, even though you know that 100% of your targets are true. And if you don't do, therefore, if you don't do the scaling down of the decoys to the level of the false positives that you have here, that you see that in this plot, if you do the scaling down, you see this red bar is basically flattening out. And I don't know if you can see here, but basically it's also, you had this gray dotted lines which captures the scaling of the red decoy distribution. And here it's basically flattened out to zero. And therefore here you can say like, I am at 0% false discovery rate until the lower score, and I retrieve 100% of my targets with absolute confidence, okay? Well, if you do a naive decoy counting, you will already stop at 1% false discovery rate and only recover only 50% of your targets, okay? So this is very important to understand that naive decoy counting doesn't work if you do targeted proteomics, and you need to have some way in order to correct for this multiple testing and scale artificially down these distributions of false of decoys in order to look as close as possible from the false targets distributions that you have in your sample. Okay, so some words about the limitation of this approach. So this is a software, it has a lot of hypotheses it starts with, and therefore you need to be sure that you're actually using the software in the proper setups. So the first thing you need to be sure is that your data set contains a certain number of good targets. So the main concept regarding this machine learning to get this separation between good targets and bad targets, the machine needs to start actually from a good data, a good peak in your data, right? So if you only measure very bad signals, the machine will try to look in your set of bad signals for a peak that looks like a peak. It will tell you that this is actually the best peak I could find in my data sets. It will learn from this bad peak to separate between what's good and what's bad. But this will be only correct if you actually provide the software with a certain number of good peaks to start with. So you need, for the training of the model, you need to have a certain number of true targets that you're sure you have in your data sets in order to get started with this training of the models. Okay? So this is the basic starting point for the machine learning. The second thing you have to be careful about is this application of the P to Q value transformations using this Torre and Tipchirani approach. It's very important that actually the assay, so I told you before, the assay should be homogeneous. And the point is that this theory of Story is basically relying on normal distributions. So you need to be sure that your assays are as normally distributed as possible. The decoy should be representative of your assays that you're measuring. There is no bias in what you're measuring, that you're providing less transitions for the decoys compared to the assays. And there you should actually always check that the pictures that you get gives you a normal distributions, okay? And again, I told you not use the decoy counting approach, naive decoy counting, and do not remove purposively bad targets from your assays. If you start removing, for example, in this case here, so this is kind of a good case scenario. You have good targets, you have the bad targets, but that's just the way it is. In this case, it was about 50% good targets, 50% bad targets. You have the decoys that captures pretty well the bad targets. And you see these p-value histogram plots as I showed you before. You have the decoys that basically span randomly a very flattened out region. And the targets to show up very strongly at p0, 0.05 and then flattens out on the p-value levels. This is a case of a bad example where you can actually hear the decoys here that you do not capture the false targets. Here you have the true targets, but you see here the false targets. For example, they're missing really the bad part of the false targets. So in this case, you can say the person maybe removed, in this case, the bad targets from his assays, okay? And then in this case, when you're measuring the decoys of those, the decoys, when you scale them down, they will actually only try to capture the very, very small part here, and therefore you will also not capture really what's the false discovery rate. So when you use those tools, you have to be aware of the different mathematics which is applied behind. And as you can see here, then if you look at the histogram plots, you see actually that the p-value of the targets here, they always go down. They actually never re-flatten out. So this is something that you will see tomorrow in the tutorial when you do this automatic peak picking and automatic scoring and false discovery rate. Have a look always at this type of histograms and be very critical about what the tool does and be aware of what is the limitation of the mathematics behind. And so I'm going to be very fast, so you're going to have the tutorial tomorrow. So Skyline allows you to generate decoys by itself. So it's now everything is embedded in Skyline. So it's very nicely programmed. You can indicate what is the type of decoys you want to generate. You can specify what's the type of model you want to use. So you will be also provided with type of plots. So always when you look at these plots, look at the distributions of the different targets and decoys. You can actually select which score makes you have the strongest power, which scores are not making sense. You can deselect it, etc. And you can look at the histograms of the individual scores, of the composite scores, and the P and the Q value plots. So this is something which is very nice in Skyline, and you can basically now only report the peaks that have a certain Q value, and therefore you can only quantify in the later part of your tutorials only the peaks on which you have a confident identification, okay? So this is my last word on that. So it's basically, I wanted to give you a view about this automatic process. So we first need to detect the peak in your chromatograms. We get a raw scoring of the peak groups, of the coalition of these different fragments. Then we generate the decoys. And then we also detect the peaks and score the decoy peaks exactly the same as the targets. And then we plot these distributions of targets and decoy distributions, scores, and then we estimate the forces rate by using the scaling down of the decoy distributions. So you can apply these recipes basically to any targeted type of approach, so like peptide-centric, and this is SRM, PRM, DIA, etc. And I think you will see that if you're doing like MS2, full scan MS2s, like you have in PRM or DIA, you will see that you can have many, many more scores than the mini scores I showed you before that were only relying on chromatography or comparison fragment to libraries. You can now use high confidence, as you saw this morning with the PRM. You can use now the high mass accuracy of the fragments. You can use the charge state of the fragments. You can use the isotope distribution, etc. So there are many, many more things that you can do if you have a high resolution MS2 machines like PRM or DIA in order to make these scores even more discriminative between targets and decoys. And these are basically the scores which underlie many of the identification software that you use or that you have heard about, and Prophet, Skyline, etc. So these are really the basics of the identifications and the statistics behind these different identifications. Okay? And again, be aware about the limitation of algorithms. So use good targets, use proper decoys, and think about the force discovery rate and the mathematics behind, okay? And this is a very important thing, really, if you want to do high throughput targeted proteomics, to have really an objective estimation of the force discovery rate in your data sets. Just not report that this is identify 100 peptides in my Skyline. You can now put like, I have a certain Q value, I have certain confidence behind these peak identifications, okay? And this doesn't replace visual identification, so if you have your ultimate biomarker, please still use Skyline to look if it's true. This software, they still do a lot of mistakes, so just be aware of, and still look by hand. It doesn't replace visual inspection of the data sets. And yeah, I thank you for your attention. You have question, or you will have the tutorial tomorrow, so I think you can also have many, many questions on the tutorial.
Yeah, very nice talk. So the LDA can do a good job of discriminating things that are more than likely true than from things that are more than likely false, but sometimes you might have one peak that passes, or more than one peak that passes the LDA. Does LDA do a good job of prioritizing which is the best, or is it just good at separating the wheat from the chaff, so to speak?
You're speaking about the case where you would have, let's say, two very good peaks in your assays, for example, or something like this. So unfortunately, at the moment, most of these softwares, I mean, it's like shotgun search, right? Even though you have, well, now people work with this delta mascot score, etc. But originally, people trusted that the higher scoring peptide database, PSM, was always the correct one, right? And now, and I agree with you, I've seen that also many, many times, especially probably even more in DIA than in PRM, where you have multiple peak groups that show up in your chromatogram, and by visual inspection, you can actually hardly tell them apart. And so in this case, you're only left with yourself, and the software actually, well, the retention time is a pretty good information. The matching to the library is a pretty good information. I've seen cases where it's not helping much. In my hands, these are very interesting modifications. No, some that you expect, some that you don't expect. I mean, deamidations, strange rearrangements. Sometimes I don't even know what those are. And then the question is what you want to do with that, right? So biologically speaking, I think it's very interesting. Quantitatively speaking, I have many people in the lab that ask me, what do I do? I see three peaks, and I think if it's your quantification is relying on that peptide, I would actually rather kick it out from my data set, just to be sure that the modification is actually not altering your quantification in your across your different sample sets. But this is actually a field where I think there's still a lot to discover and which is completely open. And if you do SWAS or DIA, this is happening a lot. And these are not necessarily interferences. These are actually modified forms of the same peptide. And this I'm 100% sure about that.
So, and then much shorter answer is that from the experiments that we've done, yeah, the LDA does a pretty good job of coming up with a score that differentiates the true peaks from the false peaks. I mean, in cases where we've done experiments where we think we know what the true peaks are and what the false peaks are, the LDA is doing a pretty good job.
So you are using the...
The question is different.
Yeah. The question is slightly different, is if you may have more than one thing that can pass that filter and they're both actually quite good peaks, does the LDA do a good job of deciding what the best peak is? And maybe that another score is required with a different sort of magnitude, rather than just separating good from bad, best from next best.
Right, so I don't think I misunderstood you. That was the question I was trying to answer, and yes, we do believe that the LDA does a good job of picking the best peak. Yeah, I mean, we have data sets where we think we know the answer, and the LDA come, you know, there may be multiple peaks that are getting, we're always considering 10 peaks, and the LDA is doing a good job of putting the best peak at the top.
But Brendan, maybe
I'm not necessarily wrong. Always, and yes, certainly I know that there are considerations like what you brought up, but basically we are doing that test to say, you know, is the LDA getting the right peak, and it is a lot.
Because I think Dario implemented the second best peak group as an estimation of the decoys as well in Skyline at some point, right? So if the second peak group, as second best peak group, is actually a true decoy or a likely target, so you can still tell them apart, but you're still reporting only the best one in the final result, right? I'm not aware you're reporting more than one peak group for each assay.
Yeah, we don't report more than one peak group. Yeah. No.
Okay. No more questions?
It's getting late. By tomorrow you have a tutorial, so you have a chance to go through all these steps one by one, and I think you can ask questions to Brendan or Ben or anybody.